Hey guys, so these are my thoughts on the Salon article in which Sui Park was interviewed. Sui Park is this kind of anti-racist Asian activist, and she started this thing recently, and it was like a big controversy apparently. I kind of missed out on the controversy when it was happening, but the whole hashtag cancel Colbert kind of thing. So she was one of the, I think she was the person that started the whole thing. And it was in reference, I didn't watch the episode of Colbert Report that did this, so I'm not really too knowledgeable about this. My video here is not really to talk about this whole controversy with what happened with the episode of Colbert Report, or necessarily what Sui Park says. I think this interview, like just reading from the comments people have, like they really, it gets pretty nasty. Like many commenters that commented on that page do not like Sui Park. Oh man, you know, and they get really upset. There are things in here that I think kind of like, you know, that people kind of point out to in this interview. Some of the things are like, oh my gosh, you know, what does a 26-year-old opinion matter, you know, about something like this? Or 23-year-old, sorry. So that's ageism. You know, like, just because somebody is young, their opinion doesn't matter anymore. That's a problem of that argument. No, I mean, you can be a 14-year-old and still have brilliant thoughts. Malala Yousaf was a Nobel Peace nominee, right? And she wrote a book. She's doing incredible work around the world, advocating for education for women in countries where women's rights are pretty, almost really bad, you know? She's 16, so age doesn't really matter in regards to a person's brilliance. So Sui Park is getting attacked because of that. She's also get attacked in this comment section, like, she's distracted, she's not being professional because she gets distracted by a bird during the interview. I guess it's not that professional, but really that's ad hominem again. Like, you're going to attack the validity of someone's comments by talking about how distracted she was in the interview. Kind of, you know, I don't know. Whatever. One of the things I think that gets a really big spark from this interview is when she says, well, how, you know, there's this part in the interview where the interviewer is like, what would you want to happen so that, you know, the white people could be on your side? And her response is, I don't want them on my side. This is a revolution, not a reform. So this is kind of a very, I think, majority of commenters are white men, I'm assuming, or white women, but majority of people in this country are white people. So of course, it wouldn't be too surprising for a majority of the commenters to be white people. I think that's pretty to be expected. So this Asian activist kind of having sparked this whole cancel Colbert thing, which to her, she explains that, you know, the intention is not, of course, to cancel Colbert Report, which is not going to happen with the hashtag. She realizes the unrealistic expectation that that was the expectation, but it really is to get the conversation rolling around the use of kind of racist stereotypes and archetypes in media, especially even by progressive liberals like Stephen Colbert. So that was kind of our purpose to doing it. To that point, I think I can sympathize well with. I think it's a pretty interesting thing to do, just kind of spark a conversation. And that's kind of the end goal of Sui Park with cancel Colbert kind of thing. And maybe some people, they look at them, they're like, that's the end purpose, that's stupid, you know. And so also the interviewer was just like, well, did you watch the episode where cancel Colbert responds to the cancel Colbert hashtag? And she's like, no, I didn't watch it. Didn't matter to me. So, you know, so that's also rises spark. She says context to that is not important. Because, like, it doesn't matter what Colbert thinks about this. It really was to spark a discussion from everyone. One person doesn't get to dictate how we should have this conversation even if that one person is Stephen Colbert. It's pretty much her point, which is a very interesting point. So people got really kind of upset. I think a lot of commenters also got upset that, like, she doesn't care about the context, and yet she took Colbert's comment, joke out of context by using this hashtag, which is, gets in the whole back and forth discussion here. It's very, I don't know, I think she makes pretty interesting points. I'm not going to say I agree with her on all the things, and I don't really know what she wants to achieve can be achieved through kind of social media tactics like this. But one thing is for sure, it does get the discussion flowing. Now, the question is, does it get, does it end up in, like, just a backlash in which people who are normally for progressive types of policies, they kind of get backlash and get defensive, you know, and the conversation shifts back to just white people trying to defend themselves. And that way, the conversation, you know, or discussion that ends up happening is a very unfruitful and very unproductive one. And so this whole cancel Colbert hashtag experiment doesn't become successful if that's what happens. And likely that's kind of what's happening, at least judging from the comment section. But this notion, I think, I want to go back to this one where the interviewer is like, so what do you want happen so that white people can join your cause? Or what do you want, how do you want the white people to kind of join your cause then? How do you want them to be on your side? And she's like, I don't care about them being on my side. This, like, white people would just be white people. And she kind of goes a little bit further, and she's like, white people are not going to be the majority in a couple more years anyway. Right? So that's an amazing thing to say, I think. Just be like, I don't care what white people think. This is a revolution for you know, non-white people. To really change the discourse. And this reminded me of when I watched the Malcolm X, the bioepic. You know, there was a moment in that movie I was just so struck. Malcolm X is visiting this college, and these group of white students, you know, they're like, "Oh, Malcolm X, hey, you're awesome, dude! Like, it's so awesome. We want to join your cause. How can we help and join your cause?" Malcolm X looks at them and says, "Nothing. Just do what you do." And he just walks into college. Like, he doesn't want help from whites. For Malcolm X in that movie, you know, it's very us against them. You know, it's this gigantic fight, power struggle between the oppressors and the oppressed. Him being a party of the oppressed, and he's going to change that. And I think any white person or non-black person kind of watching that, I think, may have felt very alienated, very like, the hell, we're trying to help, and you don't even want my help? So, and that gets anger. And I think that's kind of the point that Malcolm X or Sui Park would also want to have in this discussion. The fact that you think a person who you've been oppressing wants and needs your help, that's also a form of condescension. And that also is a form of privilege. That you're able to lend your help, and you expect that person to accept that help, even if the person doesn't want it. So I think that's one thing that I want to mention there. Do I think Malcolm X and Sui Park is necessarily right to not be more promoting alliance with, you know, because it's a tricky thing, I think. When you have an activist movement or try to have an activist movement, where anti-racism or removing racism is one of the end goals, it's probably at this point a very impossible goal to see, but it's a very worthy goal to have, sure. But how you achieve that matters, right? And people are gonna disagree on how you achieve that. Everyone is gonna disagree, no matter however you do it, right? There's Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr. are pretty really great examples of people who had the same goal but did it in a very, very different way, you know, and they both strongly disagreed with each other, you know, and that's just two figures. There's so many more figures in history that were like this. One of my like all-time kind of favorite figures in history to look back to not look up to, although I also kind of get that awe too, is I think about John Brown. And John Brown in history textbooks, in most high school history textbooks, if you look at them, John Brown is, you know, portrayed as this crazy white guy, you know, lunatic, murderous, crazy guy. But what he did was actually, like, kind of amazing. I don't know, if I lived in his time, I don't think, I'm such a pacifist myself that I don't think I would have gone along with what John Brown wanted to do, which is to really physically do violence and create a slave uprising so big that it really flipped the country around. Don't know if I would have necessarily gone along with this plan, but I think what he did was pretty, like, it was needed, looking back and in hindsight. And that's what one of the things that made such a huge impact to pretty much to change the course towards abolishing slavery in this country, you know. And I also look at Malcolm X in that kind of context as well. You know, what he did is kind of did this, you know, Martin Luther King Jr. is accepted in American society as, like, this is the model way to do activism or to fight for civil rights and whatever. But it was still, like, an extremely difficult fight. But I think the fight would have been even more difficult for Martin Luther King Jr. if Malcolm X did not exist. Because people were looking at that and being like, holy crap, look at this guy who has amassed such following and such power from the African-American populace and galvanizing them to do this. And under the force of religion that was very scared the shit out of him. I mean, it scares the shit out of most Americans now after the advent. After the events of 9/11, but even before then, Islam was a scary force to be reckoned with in America. You know, those are just kind of the thoughts that I had on this. You know, I tend to side, you know, in this interview, Sui Park's kind of points really kind of resonated with me, a lot of her points. You know, I feel like maybe she at times, it does seem like she's just kind of throwing loaded phrases out there, and kind of sounds pretentious at times. She can seem that way, which is why I think a lot of the comments on this article are just like, she's an idiot, and she doesn't know what she's talking about, and blah, 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 and you know, they're upset that she's not even trying to understand the context of Stephen Colbert and Colbert Report, and, you know, that she just throws out this comment where, don't really care of, you know, white people joining our side. That's really not the point of this discussion. You know, very dismissive, right? And when majority of the readers of this article are going to be white people, that's got to be pretty quite a thing, you know, for this person to just come up and say. But you know, she's like a, she has a, it's a weird comparison to draw, but that. On this, I think she has that Malcolm X mentality. You know, these are the things that I want to achieve in this world with these people. And I don't necessarily need your help to do it. And that's just the way it is. I feel like, you know, what can you say about that? You can hate the person back. You know, you can fight the person back. And just like, all right, fine, fuck it. If that's what you want, that's what you want. But, so this is kind of the discussion that gets sparked around. And I think, at least in that respect, if what she wanted to do with the hashtag Cancel Colbert was to just spark a discussion surrounding use of racist stereotypes or racism and media, I think it's, you know, at least it's done that. Where this discussion will lead, I'm not too optimistic, but this discussion was sparked, and I think that's quite something. Cheers.